Good morning, everybody. We are so excited because today we have our first service back in the church again. But we have decided to still continue to pre-record for you the messages in a shorter version because we know there are many of you that are not able to attend services or even that live far away. And also to eliminate technical issues so that you can focus on the Word of God. So this morning we are celebrating the goodness of God, we're celebrating His love over our lives, His faithfulness over our lives. And just where you are, if you are still at your home, worshipping at your home, come and join us this morning. Come and sing the praises of God with us. It doesn't matter if we're far away from each other, if we worship together, there the presence of God still is there. God still do mighty things. And if we want God to do mighty things, we need to continually have an atmosphere of praises unto God, of worship unto God, because He is a good God, because He is busy fulfilling His plan within your life and my life. Amen. Do you believe that this morning? Yes. Amen. Come on, let's worship God together.
I can feel you leading me by great power.
Thank you, Abba Father, that we can praise you this morning and give you the glory and the honor that is due to your name. Thank you that you are a Father that cares for each and every one of us, and that you love us, and that you have a perfect plan for each and every one of our lives. Father, this morning, thank you that we can delight in you, in your goodness, in your faithfulness, in your forgiveness, in the redemption of our lives through the blood of Jesus. Thank you, Father, that we can delight in all the works that you are doing within our lives. But most important of all, we delight in who you are. We delight in your presence. We delight in knowing that you are with us and you will never leave us nor forsake us, and that you're even working this morning within our lives. Lord, as we hear the word this morning, thank you that it changed us and that we can walk out changed people here, knowing that you are our delight, knowing that you work in every process of our lives, knowing that we are here to build in our lives, to build in other people's lives, to fulfill your purpose, and seeing the will of God, the kingdom of God being established within our lives and within our spheres where we have influence. And we thank you for that this morning in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. This morning I've got a lot to say, so let's start and get just right into the word of God. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 23 says, "And you are Christ, and Christ is God." So say with me, "I am a child of God." See, if you are in Christ and Christ is in God, you know that it is impossible to lose when you are in God. God cares for you, He provides for you, He loves you, He guides you, He leads you. And therefore, it is important for you and for me that we will find our delight in the Lord. And not in achievements, but in the process, in the journey that God is taking us in. So many people want to delight themselves in the achievement, and then they don't enjoy the process. They don't enjoy their life or the journey. But see, when we delight ourselves in the Lord, it is in the process. When we delight ourselves in the achievement, once you've achieved it, then you realize this is not what I thought it was going to be. Then you need to seek your new delight. And therefore you find there are people that are always unhappy, always dissatisfied, always complaining, always displeased, because they do not delight in the Lord. And therefore, we also looked last week at 2 Chronicles 17, verse 3 to 6. We saw Jehoshaphat. He delighted himself in the ways of the Lord. And God blessed him. He had all his riches, the honor in abundance. But yet he knew why he was there. Not because he delighted in earthly things, but he delighted in the ways of the Lord. Because here is the thing. You can be unhappy and dissatisfied and then get your money. And then you can still be unhappy and dissatisfied after you got it. And this is what happens. Many people, if you are unhappy and dissatisfied now, you will be unhappy and dissatisfied when you get that position, when you get your dream or whatever it is that you are wanting. And therefore, we see in Psalm 1 verse 2 also, that he says his delight is in the law, in the law of the Lord he meditates day and night. And he does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. He doesn't stand in the path of the sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. See, this is the opposite of delight, where you come and you're disrespectful, you ridicule, you mock even the things of God. You don't walk in those ways. You know, you can even get ungodly Christians that walk in this way. It might not mean that you're going to hell, but you are delighting in your flesh rather than delighting in the ways of the Lord. But when you delight in His commandments, now you meditate on it to see how you can apply it within every part and area of your life. And then he says, "He shall be planted as a tree by the rivers of water." So you're not one day up and down, your emotions is one day here, the next day there. No, you are planted. A confused Christian is a disobedient Christian. It is someone that does not want to apply the word of God within their lives, but they just are full of themselves. No, we meditate on the word of God. And then it also says, "You shall bring forth a fruit in its season," knowing that not every season you're going to bear fruit all the time. There might be seasons where you don't bear fruit in every area of your life, like your children's life or your marriage or your finances or your family, but still knowing in this time that God is still working within their lives. And here is a very important thing. Now you can be in your winter season, maybe not bearing fruit, and now you become depressed, displeased, unhappy, and dissatisfied. And what happens now during this season, because you are dissatisfied, this means you are not doing what you are supposed to be doing within this season. And now when the summer season comes, there will be no fruit because you were not sowing in the winter season. Therefore, many people are in the summer season, but there's no fruit within your life because in the winter you were not sowing. In the winter you were just looking for something and for an achievement. But it says, whose leaf also shall not wither. In other words, you are ever grieved, you are ever satisfied, ever happy, you forever got life. Even in the winter season, you are green. You're not one of those people that you walk in the room, you just suck the life out of everybody in that room. No, you've got joy, you've got tranquility, you've got peace. Why? Because you delight in the Lord. You delight in the ways of the Lord. And therefore, there is a joy. There is a presence about you. There is life in and around you because you delight yourself in the word of the Lord. And then he says, whatever he does shall prosper. Why? Because you delight in the Lord. You do not delight in achievements, but your delight is in what Jesus did for us. You know who you are in Christ. You know you belong to the Lord. You know you cannot lose when you are in Christ because you delight yourself in the ways of the Lord. And this brings me to today. When we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3, he has called us, we see that God has called us to be builders. And today I want to talk to you about the fact that you and I are building. We need to, first of all, be built up ourselves, but then we need to build our spouse. We need to build our family, our children. We need to build those that we have been placed at our workplace. We need thus at the end of the day to build our nation. So our text is 1 Corinthians 4 from verse 14 to 16 and 17 as well. But I want you to read, we don't have the time to read everything, 1 Corinthians 14 verse 1 to 13 to get the context of why Paul is saying the things in 1 Corinthians 4 verse 14 that he is. But in 1 Corinthians 4 from 1 to 13, when you read it, you can see from verse 1 to 4, he is saying, just to give a short summary, he says, I'm not moved by what people say or by people's judgment over my life, because I know that one day I'm going to be judged by a higher authority that even judge my motives. You know, we can do the right thing, but even if our motives are wrong, it is still sin. And then in verse 5 to verse 6, it's talking about that we should not judge our leaders. We should not say, you know, this guy is better than that guy. Verse 7, he says that how can you even judge yourself, because everything you have isn't you, meaning that everything you have, God gave you. Verse 8, he says, you think you already have everything you need. So you've got this attitude where you think you have arrived, where you are so spiritual as you can get. He says, and you think that you're reigning already. You think you are at that level already. But in verse 9 and 10, he comes and he's a bit sarcastic. He says, instead, I sometimes think God has put us apostles on display, like prisoners of war at the end of the victory parade, condemned to die. He says, we have become a spectacle to the entire world, to the people, the angels alike. Our dedication to Christ make us look like fools, but you claim to be so wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are so powerful, and you are honored, but we are ridiculed. Even now, and then he says how they are hungry and thirsty, but they work. He says they don't even have enough clothes to keep them warm. They are beaten. They don't even have a home. They work hard with their own hands. They bless those, he says, who curse them. And they are patient with those who abuse them. We appeal gently when evil things are being said to us, yet we are treated like the world's garbage. And in this context, he comes and he says, now in verse 14, I do not write these things to shame you, but as my beloved children, I warn you. Can you see he's talking to them from the point of perspective as a spiritual father? And he says, I'm warning you. You who think that you have arrived, you are so spiritual. You think you know everything. You think you can just teach everyone because everybody just wants to teach everybody something. He says in verse 15, for though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, yet you do not have many fathers. For in Christ Jesus, I have begotten you through the gospel. He says there are many instructors, many people who just want to instruct. They want just want to tell you how to do these things, but they do not take responsibility for the outcome. He says, I am not just an instructor. I am a father. I am here and I am going to make sure that you become a success. I am going to impart in your life. In other words, I am going to build within your lives. This talks about us being wise builders. And when you see yourself as a builder, you're not just instructing your children. You're not instructing those at your workplace or wherever you are. You see yourself as a builder. You are building values and the word of God into people's life. Now your attitude changes. Now you take responsibility. Now you will not be so super spiritual because you see this is hard work. You see that this is not just success in an instant. You see this is a process. This is a journey for the rest of your life. And sometimes you might not even see fruit, but you continue to build. And he says, therefore I urge you in verse 16, imitate me. And now we come, and this is a calling God has placed on you and on me. In Genesis 17 verse 4, he says to Abram, as for me, behold, my covenant is with you, Abram, and you shall be a father of many nations. So the moment God said this, he put a function, a calling on Abram, and he placed this responsibility on him to build a nation. And God said to Abram, he said, Abram, now let me talk to you about your wife. In verse 15, he said, as for Sarahi, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarahi, but Sarah shall be her name. And I will bless her and also give you a son by her. Then I will bless her and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be from her. So he says, she's not going to be the wife of the father of many nations. She is going to be in herself. She has a calling. She has a purpose. She's the mother of nations. Because without Sarah, there cannot be nations. So you've got to understand there's no confusion in regards to gender. There is power in motherhood. And it is not just about conceiving children. He says it is about a responsibility. It is about a function that you are called to build. Even if you are not married, even if you do not have children yet, you are still called to build. You are still a mother of nations, a father of nations, and you are called to build people's lives. And it says, for though you might have 10,000 instructors in Christ, you do not have many fathers, for I in Christ Jesus, I have begotten you through the gospel. So in other words, begotten is an outgrow. You are an outgrow of who you are. So we are called to multiply ourselves in the next generation. Our purpose is not to get rich or to have a lot of money or honor, but that which God has placed within you, that legacy, you need to build that into the next person within your life. That is our responsibility. And therefore, Paul comes and he says in verse 18, he says, some of you have become arrogant, thinking that we're not going to visit you. But I will come and soon if the Lord let me. Now listen to this. And then I'll find out whether these arrogant people just give pretentious speeches or whether they really have God's power. In other words, some people just talk, Pastor, you must do this. Pastor, why don't you do this at church? When are we doing this? But you yourself are not doing anything. You yourself are not even showing the power of God within your life. And he says the kingdom of God is just not just a lot of talk. It is living God's power. So it is not just being spiritual. It is doing the Bible. It is, in other words, building the nation. We need to demonstrate thus the power of God within our own lives. The wisdom of God, the grace of God, the strength of God. And then he says, which do you choose? Should I come with a rod to punish you? Or should I come with love and a gentle spirit? Once again, he's talking as a father. He's sorting these people out. Not like today, oh, you know, you're okay. Don't worry. Live in your sin. Live in your disappointments. Everything is okay. God loves you. No. He says, hey, you better get with the program. Let me help you because you've been called to be more than a conqueror. I am your father in Christ. I will make sure that you are successful. So it is not just thinking that we are super spiritual. I'm tithing. I'm going to church. I'm doing this. I'm doing that. He says, no. I urge you, you imitate me, you get into the kingdom, you start doing the work, you start impacting other people's love, then you see that spirituality grow, because now you are working. And therefore, each and every one of us, when we start taking responsibility, you will not be tweeting negative things, because you know you are responsible in building the nation. You need to take that responsibility for other people's life. It is not dependent on the government. It's not dependent on top there. The change starts with you and me from the bottom up, delighting ourselves in the way of the Lord and building in other people's lives. And next week we will continue more on this so that we can have more understanding on that. But for now, let us pray together and ask God to give us a heart that we will not always just want to learn, but that we will come to a place where we will start to teach others, to build in their lives so that they can also delight in the Lord. Just where you are, let us pray together. Our Father, we come this morning. There is so much that still needs to be said. But Lord, we come and we ask you to give us a heart for this nation, a heart for our country. Lord, give us a heart to build the kingdom of God, to build in other people's lives. Forgive us where it was just all about us and ourselves and how we can be comfortable. Forgive us where we just want to receive the word, but we're not willing to give it to others. Lord, thank you that you come now in this time and that you empower us through the word of God, through the Holy Spirit. That Father, each and every one of us, I think the one thing that a lot of people must just realize today from this word is that we are called to be a nation builder. Lord, help this to sink in people's minds, that they will know that they weren't saved just to go to heaven, but we are saved so that we can build into this nation, into this country, South Africa, that we can build in our neighborhood, that we can build our husbands, our wives, our children. And Father, thank you that you give us the wisdom how to build. And Lord, as we continue next week, that we will learn how to build in people's lives, that we in return will become everything that you have called us to be, that we in return will experience the mercy, the grace, the favor, the blessings, the anointing, the presence of God upon our lives, because we delight not just in your word, but we delight in sharing your word, in imparting in people's lives. And we thank you for that. Lord, even in this week, we ask, give us opportunities where we can build in other people's lives. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. Hallelujah. God bless you, and I'm looking forward to speak to you again next week. But remember, even if you are in your winter season now, it's important to plant and it's important to build, and you will see in the summer season the great reward, the harvest that you are going to reap. God bless you.